I think cities have always been important. People who wished to change their lot in the world, wished to get on, wished to progress, have tended to head for centres of population, for cities. That's certainly what brought me from South Wales to London to university. I regarded London as where it was at. It was where the action was. To this day, 20 and 30 somethings from around the world all want to come to London at the start of their career. They don't necessarily come because London offers the best jobs, but they do come because London offers the best party. It's where all the other young people are. Governments have misunderstood the needs of cities. I suppose this is natural because the majority of politicians in any national government will come from constituencies that are outside the great cities. And they will tend to see the average need of the country. It's what I call Ambridge planning. it's for the Archers.
Yes.
It's for a community group led by Linda Snell. And this is the sort of vision held by most national politicians. Therefore, it's not surprising that they don't quite get to grips with what London needs, and sometimes what they suggest is opposed to what London needs. It's very important that national government simply sets a framework within which the other politicians at lower level and the municipalities can work. It's always dangerous at national level to set policies that suit the average situation, but of course fit no situation in reality. Most national policies are a very loose fit. They have to be. The cities of this country are very important. They need local initiatives and local priorities. They need to be allowed to succeed or fail if that's what they choose to do. And I think once national governments start to step in and try to prevent local authorities or cities failing, then the danger is that they will constrain the successful ones in the process. So you need much more freedom for individual authorities to decide what is right for them and to get on with it. Good planning and balanced land use doesn't preclude development, it simply channels it. London needs a mixture of uses. There's no doubt London needs more office buildings. The vacancy rate just across the river in the City of London at the moment has fallen to about 6 or 7%. The minimum healthy vacancy rate to allow people to expand and find offices is 8%. In the western part of the city, closest to the West End, it's down to 1 or 2% as a result of the high levels of residential conversions that are going on in the West End, which are pushing more office occupiers eastwards into the City of London. Other parts of London, we are seeing major residential developments. At Vauxhall Cross, a mixed-use scheme which was for residential, office and hotel was recently put back in for a revised planning permission, and the offices have all disappeared. Surprise, surprise, they were found to be less viable than building even more high-end apartments and a larger hotel. The market will obviously seek the most profitable use of the land, but the profitable use of the land depends on the planning permission which is granted. The value of land is created by planning permission. So, if you want to bring down the cost of land in London, if you want to bring down the price of housing for people that genuinely need to live here, one of the best things you can do is to constrain the wrong kind of development. So, that kind of development constraint would be a win-win situation. London is too strong to be killed even by the residential investors and the residential developers that are currently changing its skyline. The future of London isn't in the trophy apartments, it isn't in One Hyde Park, it isn't the penthouse of the Candies. The future of London is in railway arches in Vauxhall. It's in the nightclubs, it's the party, it's what the young people are doing. It's not what the uber-rich do that changes London. After all, they're not home very much. they're latchkey kids. They have to be out most of the time. It's the youngsters who come to London because they think it's a wonderful place to have fun that will keep it alive. And luckily, London has a railway viaduct running all the way from Battersea in the west to Bermondsey in the east. If you look at the uses that have inhabited those railway arches over recent years, they're almost all to do with leisure. They're almost all to do with youth. And that, to me, is the strongest indicator that London will survive the worst excesses of developers, architects and planners.
My guest has been Peter Wynne Rees. Peter, thank you very much for being part of Think Cities.
It's been a pleasure.